Welcome to this web lecture on dealing with an uncertain future. In 1943, Thomas Watson, chairman of IBM, said, "I think there's a world market for maybe 5 computers." Of course, the computer he was thinking of was a large mainframe computer, like the ENIAC that you see in this picture. He could not know that it would be PCs, laptops, tablets, smartphones, and so on and so forth, and that nearly everybody would have one computer in the future, or even more than one computer. Still, this shows that it's hard to predict, especially if it concerns the future, as Niels Bohr already said. In this lecture, we will look at how we can deal with an uncertain future in responsible innovation. We will do so by first looking at the so-called Kollingwitz dilemma. We will then sketch the limits to anticipating the future. And as an alternative, I will sketch an experimental approach, new technologies as social experiments. And finally, I will discuss titanium dioxide nanoparticles in sunscreens as an illustration of this. But let us start with the Kollingwitz dilemma. This states that in the early phases of technological development, technology can still be changed. But in these phases, the effects of the technology are hard to predict. In the latter phases, we see the opposite. The effects are clear, but the technology is so well embedded in society that it is hard to change. Now, as we have seen in a previous lecture, most of the current approaches to the Kollingwitz dilemma focus on anticipation. This means that an attempt is made to make technology more predictable. And I will look here in 2 ways of anticipation. First, the so-called risks approach and the precautionary principle. And I will discuss the limits of these approaches. The risk approach proceeds as follows. First, determine the risk of a new technology. And then decide whether this risk is acceptable. Now, risk is here understood as probability times effect. However, the problem is that in many cases, we do not know probabilities, and this results in what we will call uncertainty. Sometimes we do not know all possible consequences, and this is called ignorance. And as a consequence of not knowing probabilities or effects, we cannot determine risks. Now, an alternative approach that tries to avoid this is the so-called precautionary principle. Now, there are many formulations of it, but I will give you an often used one. This is the following. It says, when an activity raises threats to the environment or to human health, precautionary measures should be taken. And this should happen even if some cause and effect relations are not fully established scientifically. Now note that this principle does not require the establishment of probabilities. It can therefore deal with what I have called uncertainty. Still, the principle has 2 main drawbacks. First problem is that it gives sometimes conflicting advice and is incoherent. Now, let us consider the following case. We want to apply the precautionary principle to the capture and storage of carbon dioxide. In the Netherlands, it was proposed to store carbon dioxide below the town of Barendrecht, which is close to Rotterdam. And this led to heated opposition. Now, if we apply the precautionary principle to this case, well, on the one hand, one might say, yes, we should capture and store carbon dioxide because it contributes to greenhouse effect. And this is a danger. But the problem is that we might equally well say, when we apply the principle, no. Because if carbon dioxide escapes from the storage facility, it might be in danger for public health. Now, both of the applications of the precautionary principle refer to possible, but not completely certain dangers. So on the ground of the principle alone, we cannot make a decision. We rather get conflicting advices. Now we come to the second problem of the precautionary principle. And that is that it cannot deal with ignorance. Now, ignorance may lead to what is known as unknown unknowns. This picture gives a nice illustration of what unknown unknowns are. So the above means that there will always be surprises, and there will always be unexpected developments when we introduce new technology in society. The European Expert Group on Science and Governance expressed this in 2007 as follows. They said, we are in an unavoidably experimental state. Yet, this is usually deleted from public view and from public negotiation. But if citizens are routinely being enrolled without negotiation as experimental subjects in experiments which are not called by name, then some serious ethical and social issues would have to be addressed. Now, the approach that I propose is to conceive of the introduction of new technology into society as a social experiment, and then to ask the question, under what conditions are such experiments morally acceptable? Now, to make this more clear, I would like to illustrate this by a case study on titanium dioxide nanoparticles in sunscreens. Some fear that these nanoparticles might cause cancer. And indeed, in 2006, the International Agency of Research on Cancer said that titanium dioxide is a possible cause of cancer. However, the problem is that titanium dioxide comes in different sizes, and it is not known whether the nanoparticle size is also dangerous. Still, some of the opponents of nanoparticles already call those particles the new asbestos. So there is a huge debate. Now, in 2006, the Health Council of the Netherlands forced the following advice on nanoparticles. And their advice, they said, was based on the precautionary principle. And they said, before nanoparticles are brought onto the market, their toxicological properties should be properly investigated. And they said that the goal of this investigation is to make nanoparticles a simple risk problem instead of an uncertain risk problem. Now, of course, this sounds like a sensible advice, but the second part especially overestimates the possibility for assessing risks beforehand, before the technology is introduced in society. Actually, for three reasons, the risk of nanoparticles can only to a limited extent be determined beforehand. First, there are long-term cumulative and interaction effects that cannot be tested in the laboratory. Second, lab tests are often not representative of real-life circumstances. And third, ignorance. An interesting example of ignorance is the appearance of defects on pre-painted steel roofs. These turned out to be caused by titanium dioxide from sunscreen used by workers during installation, and nobody had ever expected this. Now, due to the reasons I mentioned, the current introduction of titanium dioxide particles in sunscreen is a kind of social experiment, if you like it or not. But the question is it also an acceptable experiment? In an article we wrote on this topic, we have formulated four principles for acceptable experimentation in this case. The first principle is that there are no other ways of acquiring the knowledge required from complete risk assessment. A second condition was that the experiment should be controllable. And this controllability includes the following things. First, it includes monitoring of possible effects. It includes the feedback of these effects to the design process. It also includes the containment of possible risks. And finally, it improves a conscious, credible upscaling of the experiment. Now, a third principle for responsible experimentation is what's called informed consent. Informed consent is, in fact, one of the main ethical principles to judge the experiments with human subjects, whether these are acceptable. And this principle says human subjects should be completely informed about risks and about expected benefits. They should also freely and knowingly consent to the participation in the experiment. Now, if we translate it to our specific case, there are two more specific conditions that follow from this. First, consumers should be informed. And secondly, consumers should be able to end their participation in the experiment. Now, let's go to the fourth condition for responsible experimentation. This condition is the proportionality of risks and benefits. In this case, the risk was still so uncertain that we reformulated this principle a little bit. And now reads as follows. There should be a continuous review of the risks, and decisions about continued use should be based on that review. So we should continuously look at it. If we apply these four conditions to the case at hand, it turned out that the following conditions are not fulfilled. First thing, more risk assessment could have been done before the introduction of nanoparticles into the society. What was also missing was monitoring, labeling, and continuous review. On basis of this, we made the following recommendation. First, we recommended to close the existing knowledge gaps as far as that is reasonably possible. Second, we advised to monitor possible effects of nanoparticles. Third, we advised to take necessary action if needed on the basis of such monitoring. Fourth, ongoing design for safety. One possibility here is to design nanoparticles in such a way that they can be traced, and this would help monitoring. The final recommendation that we made is to change the law to legally require both monitoring and labeling. Now, at the end of this web lecture, I want to return to the Collingwood's dilemma with which I started. What we have seen is that anticipation tries to attack the first horn of the dilemma by making technology more predictable. But, as we have seen, there are limits to this. Now, the idea that I discussed of new technologies as social experiments attacks the second horn of the dilemma. It accepts that some effects only become clear as technology are introduced into society. However, it tries to avoid that technology get too soon entrenched in society. I hope to have made clear what the advantages of such an alternative approach are. I want to thank you for your attention.